PR if you want.
Yeah.
All right, well, welcome back. I'm running a little behind schedule, but I don't like to rush, so I just dropped a couple of things that I think you can look up in the specs. There were two questions that I'd like to answer. Both are actually very good comments that I should have made. When I say use private data as much as you can, that's mostly scalar variables. Very often your arrays and vectors and other data structures are shared. But sometimes you need like a helper vector, and those you'd like to have private. So usually the additional memory requirements are very modest. So you use shared memory, when you think about it, most of shared memory data is red. And when you start writing, sometimes you can write it in a smaller local buffer and then share it with the bigger output. So don't get me wrong. Don't think that you need an excessive amount of memory, additional memory, to run an OpenMP program, because in practice that doesn't happen. There's always the exception. Usually it's the scalars that you've got to be careful. The other question was in my barrier example where I had that two loops. Yes, you can tell the OpenMP system that the thread working on iteration I should work on iteration I in the next loop. That was not guaranteed in the earlier versions of the specifications, but at a certain point that was introduced because that's like a nice thing to have. So you can do that. That's when you do the static. When you do the static schedule that I'll talk about very soon, then you get that guarantee. But I'm going to talk about a subset of the directives. I'll cover most, but here and there I'll leave out details, and then some big chunks will follow in the last part. So, what is your toolbox? The work sharing, again, where threads distribute the work, is the for or the do loop in Fortran. I talked about it already. I'll be very brief on it. Then there's a new thing called sections. With sections, you can basically have independent chunks of work that are executed in parallel. So if you'd like to do a matrix multiply in parallel with a Fourier transform, sections are the way to go. You put each in a section, and those sections will execute in parallel. It's typically meant for higher level of parallelism, where you break down your problem in high, function calls. And keep in mind that within each section, you can go parallel again. It doesn't restrict your parallelism necessarily. You can use nested parallelism, you can use tasking, you can use other constructs. So, but again, sections were meant to be a fairly high level. Single, very simple, one thread will execute whatever you put. And I'm going to talk about all of these right now. In Fortran, there's a fourth one, simply to parallelize array syntax. You have array syntax and you want to have that parallelized with OpenMP. There's the work share directive. Very straightforward. It doesn't even have a clause other than the no wait, and that's it. The for or the do in Fortran, again, very straightforward. You break the iteration space over the distribute that over the threads available. And how you want to do that, you get all the control that you like. And I'll show that in a minute. Here's a simple example. I have two loops. The first loop computes B. The second loop computes D. And here comes the choice. And actually, I'm actively looking at an application that exactly made that mistake. You could do a pragma OMP and make a full parallel region out of the first loop and have a second full parallel region out of the second loop. And that'll be more expensive than saying, wait a minute, I make one big parallel region and I embed those two loops in it. Rule number one. And it does help. So what I do here is my OMP4, I use the no wait because the computation of D is independent of the computation of B. So why have a barrier here? And I do the same for the last one because in any case, there's an implied barrier at the end of the parallel region. So I can just safely eliminate two barriers. And otherwise, I'll get more communication calls. So that's how it executes. The master thread will hit the parallel region. And at that point, they'll distribute the iterations and so forth for the next one. Right? I hope that's very clear by now. Unfortunately, many, many people bashing OpenMP never got beyond this slide. So we'll go further. Related to loops is a special type of operation that as written cannot be parallelized in a straightforward way, but as an algorithm, it can be parallelized. And the easiest example, and I switch to Fortran here, is the summation of vector elements. If I would do this with a parallel do or a parallel for in C, multiple threads would read sum at the same time and try to modify it. And sum is a shared variable. That can't go well because they all try to read and write the same memory address at the same time, and that's called a data race. And what that means is you get unpredictable results, and for sure they're wrong. Sometimes they're right, but that's just because you're lucky or maybe unlucky. You should see the wrong results. That's called the data race, a known bug in shared memory programming. So I can't just do OMP parallel do with them. I can't do it. But as an operation, it can be parallelized because what I can do, I can give independent summations to threads. You do this part, you do this part, and then I glue it all together. And that's called a reduction operation. And there's a very convenient clause in OpenMP that says reduction. It gives you the operator, like the plus in this case, and the variable it applies, my variable sum. Now, there's a whole formal mechanism behind this, and what is exactly a reduction operation, like the minimum and the maximum are reduction operations. I will not cover that to check the specifications for that, but it's a very convenient construct to have, and the compiler will generate the low-level code for you to ensure the right result. So think about it. Don't forget it. So here's the gory details that I will skip in interest of time. Again, check the specifications. It's very well documented what exactly is classified as a reduction. Now, for some people, that was not good enough. They said, well, I would like to have my own reduction. And that was introduced in 4.0. Not for the faint of heart, but if you really want to redefine the notion of reduction and say, whatever I do is a reduction, you can do that. And I'm sure some people can benefit from that, so that's why I want to mention it, but I will not go into detail. Okay. Not for the faint of heart, but it works. Here's a little one. It's called the loop collapse. Loop parallelism has this problem that if the loops are short and you only parallelize one level, then your parallelism is limited. What if this outer loop here on this slide is only 6 long? Then I won't be able to use more than 6 threads. That's kind of a pity, because what if the other loop is like 5 long? Well, if I can combine them, make one iteration space 30 iterations, I get more parallelism. That's the idea behind loop parallelism. The collapsing, sorry. And an area where this is useless, for example, Fourier transforms. They're usually short loops, and you can glue them together. That's called loop collapse, and you specify the number of loops to follow. They have to be perfectly nested, no code in between, and then the compiler will generate the code for you. Very convenient. You could write your own, but it's very ugly. So think about loop collapse when you have short loops. Another thing I want to mention, it's kind of a topic in itself, is 4.0 has support for SIMD, single instruction, multiple data. I'm sure many of you are familiar with that. It's also called microvectorization. There's different words for it. But what it boils down to is that you have one, in this case, like one 64-bit data element that has four 16-bit smaller elements, and I can do all the whole operation on four elements at the same time. It's like a micro parallelism thing. It's called SIMD, single instruction multiple data. And with OpenMP now, you can tell the compiler, I want you to generate code for that. If available, of course, if the architecture supports instructions like this. So there are two ways you can use that to parallelize a serial loop or you can do it in a parallel loop and get two-level parallelism. Again, a topic in itself. I just want to mention that if you're interested in this, check the specs, talk with other people. You'll come to our tutorial later this year, but that's the thing. So this is all kind of related to loops. That was one work sharing construct. The next one I want to cover is parallel sections. I want to sketch this. It's extremely simple. You have your code blocks and whatever, it's a kind of base thing in Fortran, you don't use the curly braces, sorry. But what you have your code blocks and anything you put in there will be executed in parallel by as many sections as you have. Number of sections is your level of parallelism. If you have 5 sections, you'll be using 5 threads. If you have less threads than sections, it will wrap around. If you have more threads than sections, some threads will be idle. So, same example with these two loops, but now handle 2 sections. And what we have here is one section doing the full update on B, and another one in parallel doing a full update on D. So the behavior is totally different. I now only have 2 threads active. I didn't do a fair chunk of work. Not much more to say about sections than that, other than show you an example that nobody seemed to have thought about what you can do with sections. This is from the book, and again, you can download the code that actually implements this. It overlaps I/O and computation, which is a big thing, of course, in many, many cases. You've got your I/O, it's usually slow, and you have to compute. So if under the assumption that you can read a chunk of data, start processing, and then read the next chunk, so you don't have to read all of your data to start working, you can do the following trick. There are imaginary kind of threads designated to certain tasks. One thread will do the input. It will read that file. 1, 2, and so forth. Then, as soon as block 0 has been read, the processing threads start working on it, and for cosmetic reasons, there will be some output as well. The basic idea is between the reading and the processing, because the processing thread has to wait for the read to be completed. So here's a way to implement that. I have 3 sections. The first section implements my input thread idea. The middle section does the processing, and the third one does the output. The output is cosmetic. The idea is in these first 3. So what it does in a loop way, it will read input block I, and it will post a flag, which is just simply an array that I created. And it has a value, and if that value changes, it means the flag has been posted. Nothing really sophisticated. But meanwhile, remember these are sections, so meanwhile, this executes as well. Both executing parallel, and actually with the third one as well. So this one will wait for that particular read to be finished. And once it's finished, it will start processing the data. And then it will send the flag to the output set. So it works. And again, you can download it. This does use the flush module. The example I earlier gave with this array called execution state is from this code, where you're waiting for something to be finished. All right, those sections, quite flexible. The last work sharing construct actually doesn't share work. Kind of a funny name. It's called single. And it does what the name implies. Only one thread will do the work. And there are good reasons why you sometimes want to do that. And here's an example. What if I do some I/O? And I think that's, in particular, when you have a distributed memory background, when you do I/O on a shared memory system, what you can do is have one thread read it into a shared data structure, and then all threads have access to it. So you don't have to duplicate, you don't have to stand up things. You can use the single. The single has an implied barrier, and I often want to leave that out. You don't have to do that. If you don't use the no wait here, you're fine. But what if I use the no wait? Because the other threads will say, well, that's not for me. They'll skip it. They'll continue. I don't want to have them wait until I start using that data. Then I need to have a battery. So in that way, what will happen here is one thread will do the I/O. The other threads will happily continue with whatever they can do until they hit that barrier, because I want to make sure that A has been read by the time I start using it. Again, without the no wait, this will be simpler. Okay, but I lose some asynchronous behavior. I hope that's clear. That's single is used for initializations and print state. In a parallel region, you usually want to have a message printed once, unless it's that specific. So you put it in a single region and one will print it. So the behavior is as shown here, again, very straightforward. And here's the syntax. Not much else I want to say about it. That's a funny thing. They're work sharing shortcuts. So instead of writing pragma OMP parallel with just one for loop, I can shortcut it to OMP parallel for. Same in Fortran, of course, and the same for the work sharing Fortran, and the same for section. For a while, I wondered, so what's the big deal? It saves me some bytes of my disk. Oh, disk space is not that expensive anymore, so who cares? Well, actually, this is a simpler construct, so the compiler can do more optimizations. A full parallel region is pretty heavy, everything going on there. So now it knows, okay, there's only one loop, and I can eliminate a lot of overhead. Now, of course, you could wonder, why don't compilers do that for me? Maybe one day they will, but until then, just do it yourself, and it does help. I found out it does help. So think about these shortcuts as a way to streamline performance. Another construct I want to mention is the critical region. As I had my example before with the reduction, you've got to be careful when you're reading and writing the same memory address by multiple threads, because you have to do that in some sort of controlled way, otherwise you'll get undefined results. If they're all randomly read the whatever bit pattern is there, then you get wrong results, and that's a data race. The reduction could be one, but what if I don't want or cannot use the reduction? That's where the critical section or critical region comes in very handy. You define a block of code, doesn't have to be one statement, to be critical section. And what that means, all threads will execute it, but the guarantee is only one at a time. So you never ever have the risk that multiple threads update the same variable at the same time. So it's a great way to avoid any races from happening. And I think what you'll find is most of you will use a critical region somewhere in record. It's a very common thing. Now, the critical region is not without cost, as most of these things. So don't clutter your program with critical regions all over. But certainly, if you really need them, they're extremely convenient to use. And the syntax is absolutely straightforward. You can give a name to a critical region, and theoretically it means that critical regions with different names can be executed in parallel. So you give the implementation the freedom to do that. Otherwise, they all default to the same anonymous thing, and they will be executed in order. So depends on how fancy you want to go and how desperate you're scrambling for performance, but it's there. All right. That's kind of the first helicopter view of the toolbox. More to follow. I'm now going to list the environment variables. I'll do that fairly quickly. I mean, nothing more boring than go through a list of environment variables. I just want to point out something. Again, this is, you can just open the specs and read it. My all-time favorite from the moment it was introduced in 4.0 is OMP display end. please use it. What it will do, a program startup, it will echo all the environment variable settings. And the number of times it has saved me from a fatal mistake in my script being significant. So maybe I'm the only user, but definitely I can recommend using it. And you can control, there's a low output version and a verbose way, it dumps a lot of things, and absolutely, certainly when you're developing your code and developing your environment, I can highly recommend to use it. The rest is pretty straightforward. OMP num threads, you set the number of threads. You can control how many threads are ever going to be generated. That was particularly useful with nested parallelism, because that would grow very, very quickly. With tasking, same thing, you can generate many, many tasks, and maybe that gets out of hand. Dynamic, I mentioned, you can change the number of threads as the program executes. Now it's time to give the rule. The rule is you can only do that at or before the parallel region, not inside, which makes sense. In the parallel region, the work has been defined. You can't all of a sudden say, oh, I changed my mind. I want to have 12 extra threads. No, that doesn't work. That's illegal. You can do it, and you'll probably get very undefined funny behavior. But outside of the parallel region, you can specify how many threads you want. There's also a clause on the parallel region to say, I want you to use this number of threads. So you can grow and shrink. Nested parallelism, you can enable, disable it. Same for nested parallelism, you can control how deep you want to go, because again, it's easy to hang up your system. And there's a thing called stack size. And that warrants a full slide on its own, which I will do now. Why? Well, let me first explain how things usually work. You have a function and you call that in parallel, and the global variables, they'll go on the heap, and that's all fine and good. The local variables are the ones to be careful with, because they go onto the stack of that function. And the stack is a block of memory managed by the compiler that's used for local space. You may not be aware of it. If all went well, you've never seen it. You've never seen your code die because of stack space problems. But for those of you who did, they know how ugly that is. Code will usually die in some horrible way because there's not enough stack space to manage your local storage requirements. Now, nothing different here. A thread will have its own local space, and that's on the stack. And you get a certain portion of stack space allocated per thread initially. If that's sufficient, that's fine. If it's not sufficient, it's not fine. And I've seen several people, they wildly started debugging their code, and all I had to say was, did you change the stack size? No. Okay, that solved the problem. So that's why I really want to call this out. It's a nasty one. Systems tend to, in the ideal world, I would like to see a message on my screen saying, sorry, I ran out of stack space. This is what I need. Could you please? No. You just get the code up. So that's the way things are. So keep in mind the stack space. How much you need? I think it's trial and error. So not a pretty part of the story, but that's kind of the way OSs seem to handle things. Okay, stack space. So think about, one more thing. The stack space, and I'm not even sure why that was chosen a long time ago. The default unit is kilobytes, not bytes. You wouldn't be the first one asking for terabytes of stack space, because there's a factor of 1024 in between. You can specify the unit now. You can say, give me 4K, 4M. But if you don't say that, if you say stack space, stack size equals 4, you get 4 kilobytes, not bytes. Just a little catchy. And your thread will again die in a horrible way if that stack space is not available in the system. Okay. Environment variables, you'll see a lot about places and profiling. That's for the affinity control. There are environment variables for accelerators, thread cancellation, and again, I'll cover all of these. The weight policy, I already mentioned, active or passive. And you can control the work distribution, how things are being scheduled, and I'll cover this as well. The runtime functions, there's a long laundry list that I just deleted in the break because I want to talk about more interesting things. They're useful, but they're all in the specs. You can use them as much as you like. They all start with OMP underscore. And in Fortran, you need to load a module or include a file. In C, you need to include file OMP.h for these functions to be recognized. So I just said that there's a long list. They're absolutely very useful, but I don't feel like I should do a long list here. Sure.
Question?
Yep. Okay.
What's the difference between SIMD and Power of 4? General question.
Okay. Yeah. The difference, so the question is the difference between the 4 and the SIMD. The SIMD is a lower level. The 4, you can do anything you want in that loop. SIMD is for certain operations only, like an add, subtract. So it goes directly, it's very low level, it directly goes, interfaces into the instruction set of a chip. And compilers are actually supposed to do that for you, but you can take full control if you don't want to rely on that. So it's a lower level.
There's another question of tasking and instruction. I'd like you to hold this question.
Yeah, tasking will be covered in gory detail soon, or almost gory detail. All right. Using OpenMP, I'm just going to show more bits and pieces of OpenMP, how to use it. What I just described, introduced, gets you going in many, many cases. But once you start really using it for your application, there may be some other features that you need. And I try to cover as much as I can out of those. An important one is how to handle load balancing, where threads don't finish at the same time because one just gets more whipped for others. For that, on the loop, on the for and do loop, you get the schedule clause. The easiest one is a static distribution of the work. What it means is these n iterations are predefined, chopped up, and assigned to threads. So it's very predictable. Each thread will get, if you have a loop of 100 iterations, and you get 10 threads, they all get 10 iterations to work on. That's very fast, very efficient to do, but it may be too rigid for your application if you have a triangular matrix and you're doing work on that. Not necessarily all threads do the same amount of work. So there are many cases where static is just not good enough. For that, you get dynamic or guided. Dynamic and guided are related. And I'll show you an example next. But with dynamic, there's a pool of work, and whenever a thread is finished, it'll get the next portion of work from the pool. So if one takes longer, it won't block the other one. So it's a good way to handle load balancing problems. Guided is related, and then actually that's my favorite because I can use it quite often in these cases. Guided, you start with a big chunk of work, and as time goes by, it shrinks. And that makes sense because load balancing becomes an issue towards the end of your computation. When they're all starting to wind down, and you want to make sure that you have fine pockets of work to allocate to make sure that they all keep busy. But for performance, initially, you want to have big chunks. The problem is you don't know up front what's good or bad. So that's why I like the runtime clause. With the runtime clause, I can set this environment variable and play with scenarios. What happens if I set it to dynamic? What if I set it to guided? For the really optimistic under us, there's auto, where you fully trust the compiler to do the right thing for you. Okay, that's it. Again, the choice is yours. I find that either static or often, if there's a load balancing problem, guided are my solution. And I do the first proof of concept studies with the runtime. So it can easily play. Otherwise you have to rebuild your code. And you have to recompile that part because you got to modify the source to change the clause. There's an optional chunk size. The chunk size is the granularity of the work. And you can set it to anything. And if you don't set it, the system will give you a default. So you've got two parameters to play with. What should I choose for the algorithm, and what should be the chunk size? And again, good reason to consider the runtime. And the runtime functions allow you to change this on a loop by loop basis, if you like. So you can set it for a specific loop, saying for this loop, I need this, and another one, I need something else. So you get full flexibility. Here's a very simple example. I have a loop of length 16, and I'm using four threads with static. With static, if I don't specify a chunk size, I probably get the first four iterations assigned to thread 0, the next four assigned to thread 1, and so on. That's very efficient. If I would say chunk size 2, the first two iterations will be assigned to 0, the next two will go to 1, and so forth, and then they'll wrap around. Again, the choice is yours. And this slide basically just summarizes what I just said, so I'll skip it. I want to show a picture. Just showing it works as advertised. What I did, I took a loop, 500 iterations, and I recorded which thread was executing which iteration under different schedules. So you see on the vertical axis, you see 0, 1, 2, 3, those are the four threads. And what you see here, thread 0 at the bottom, that red block, it took the first 125 iterations. In parallel, of course, that this is not about time, this is about iteration. In parallel, thread 1 took the next 125 and so on. This one is more dynamic. Actually, I should run it twice, and you'll probably see a difference in distribution. Unfortunately, the resolution of this slide doesn't allow me to show. This is 5 iterations, because I said dynamic, 5. That means each time you go to the pool, you get a chunk of 5 iterations. Guided, you can see it looks like thread 0 here got started first. It got the biggest chunk of work. Then thread 2 is the next biggest one, and so forth. And as you proceed, it gets smaller and smaller. Again, just to illustrate, it works in length of time. And definitely worth considering when you're in this kind of scenario. Okay, another one, totally different. It's called the master. The master is a block of code where you force the system to have it executed by that master thread. Beats me why you need it. But there's one catch, again, for all these things, it never happens to me, but there's no implied barrier on it. So when you use this to initialize some data, the master will happily initialize your data. The other threads will skip it, saying, that's not for me. And it could start using data that hasn't been initialized. Okay. Single is safer because there's an implied barrier. And actually, I maybe in a break, if somebody can explain to me why the master's really needed, why would I have a certain preference for it, the master thread. Master thread tends to be busy anyhow because it's kind of managing the parallel region. But again, it's there and available. As we're in somewhat mildly bashing mode already, here's the next one. Order. Well, this is for a loop, loop only. What you do, you have your parallel loop, and in that loop, you declare a block of code, doesn't have to be one statement, to be ordered. Bunch of statements. And what it tells the system is these will be executed in the originally sequential order. Even if I can imagine why you would need that other than debugging your code, there's usually other ways to do it. It's expensive. It slows you down tremendously. And again, if you want to use this, then think about maybe there's another solution to that problem because this is expensive. And I did use it recently to make sure that a database indeed came from that part of the code. So as a debugging tool, it's useful. Whether you want to do this in production, I don't know. The call is yours. Out of bashing mode. Atomic operations. Atomic operations, and some will criticize me for that, but I'm an application person, I'm not a computer scientist, is they are like a critical region, but extremely fine-grained, so very efficient. The idea but keep that in mind, it is like a critical region. The idea is that systems have instructions for these kind of operations, so you get maximum efficiency. So definitely use them. As the years went by, the atomic has been enhanced. So just to make sure that everybody you know, understands atomic operation. I put in some code here. What it is, essentially, it is an operation you can't break down any further, as suggested by the name. Although I think the physics people have found out that atomic is not really at the atomic level, but doesn't matter. Atomic means you can't break it down. And a very simple example is I want to increment this variable x. And again, I don't want to have multiple threads do the same update at the same time, because then I get a data race and defined results. So a critical region would be valid here, but that's heavy. This is very lightweight. So syntax is very simple, atomic and a clause. And the clause is UR is, I just want to read that variable atomically. I want to write it atomically. I want to do an update, x++, for example. I want to capture the old or the new value. And there's a thing called sequential consistency. Now, unfortunately, that sequential consistency forces me to talk about really ugly things that I'll be quick about. You touch upon a whole kind of worms in parallel programming where you want to have things done in a certain order. If you feel that that should happen, then sequential consistency is your friend. But again, in interest of time, I don't want to go too far with that. Just want to show you some examples. Here, the atomic capture is where you have the capture statement where you grab a value and then you update that variable. Like here, I want to keep the old value in an atomic way, and then I update it. And in some applications, that's a natural requirement. So originally, this was not available for the atomic. So again, it's there, and definitely consider using them if you think they're applicable. Sequentially consistent atomics, again, I'll take a rain check on that. This is what it is. It's fairly demanding in terms of performance, so you are going to give up some performance. And again, if that's what you need, then consider it. But be careful. Don't use it unless you really think you need it. Now, here's a next topic that I think is general enough to warrant some slides and some time. Global data, Fortran, common blocks, for example. Module data, whatever is shared among threads requires care, because all this global data is automatically shared. All threads can access it. So I'll just show you by ways of an example what you could run into and how you could fix it. Okay, for an example, I call a subroutine, and I do that simply with just a simple parallel do. I use a module that defines my data types, declares my data types. And inside that function that I'm calling in parallel, I initialize a vector B. Again, airplane flight, warning, airplane flight. But I initialize a vector B, and then I update an array A. Now, the problem is this is global. This was declared to be a global vector. And hence, I have a data race here on B. And let me show you why. A is fine, as I'll show as well. So let's say we execute this on two threads. By the way, that's what I always do, because if I can't understand it, same performance. If I can't understand it on two threads, how can I ever pretend to understand higher threads? So you start with two, and the problem is immediately clear, I hope. One thread will call subroutine A with an argument of 1, that was my variable J. The other one will call with J equals 2. So this one will initialize B to 1. And presumably, the same time, this one will initialize B to 2. And that was 1 B. It's a shared array. And the damage is done. This is fine, because A is indexed over the J. So there's a unique column of A that will get some value. And this is doing the damage. Again, it's again a data race. And it ties into the question that was asked about data reuse. this one, when you think about it, in sequential mode, I recycle that array. Each time that I call that function, I reinitialize it to something, so I reuse that memory. Now I want to do that in parallel, so I do need multiple copies of that vector. That's the way it is. I'll show you the ugly solution first, and then the real way to do it. The ugly solution would be to say, well, wait a minute, the problem was that each thread needs its own space for B. So they all need to have a local copy. So I can figure out or set how many threads I have. I make B two-dimensional, and I use the thread idea, which is guaranteed to start with zero, as an index into that array, and I'm fine. And that'll work. This will work. I use the thread idea, and that starts with zero. So I add one, there's Fortran, and now I get unique access over all the columns and all as well. But it's ugly. And you need to figure out where B is used. You need to change everything. That's not the way to do it. The way to do it is to use the Pragma OMP thread private construct in OpenMP. That does exactly what I did by hand, but now the compiler and runtime system handle it for me, and I don't have to do anything other than declare B to be thread private. Great feature, really great feature. It works, I mean, I use it myself. So I'll show you how you would do this. So in my module file, I do OMP thread private B. That's the only change I need to do here. That's it. Sounds like a sales pitch, but it works. So,
And which is the difference between thread private and only private?
Because you can't make the whole structure, unless you're in the function, you could give it a private copy. That would be another solution. So what you could do in the function, you can declare B, and then it will be private automatically. But then you would have to change your source in your function and make it a private array. Now the assumption is this is shared. That's the assumption. So that's what I need for whatever reason. The more natural thing would indeed to have it local to the subroutine anyhow and have it a private. The one thing I need to mention here, if this is a private variable in a way. So again, undefined on entry and exit. So there's a copy in clause to copy in the original values it had, if you want to do that, just as with the first private. So if it has predefined values you want to have, then there's a copy in which translates to a runtime copy. So there's some cost with it, but in that way you can inherit the values it had before. Okay, that was a fairly wide, almost random overview of OpenMP. I'm now going to zoom in on some more recent functionality. Most of this has been there for quite a long time. And that's going to be the end of the overview talk, but I'll take my time for that. So I'm not very creative. I couldn't come up with any other name than additional functionality. It's just more what you have. My disclaimer is I will zoom in on two topics, tasking and CC NUMA. The other ones I will briefly mention. If you want to have more, then come to Aachen in Germany. There's the OpenMPCon and the IWOMP event, and that's where there's a boatload of tutorials where you'll get all the exposure to all of these topics as much as you like. And for those of you that can't come to Aachen, Maybe you can go to supercomputing, because our tutorial got accepted, a full day advanced OpenMP tutorial, same thing, like an hour and a half on accelerators and more than you ever wanted to know about Cindy, and so just go there and spend the day with us. All right. So indeed, OpenMP continues to evolve, no doubt about it. And two things that people kept on asking about. CC NUMA support, accelerators. Yes, but the easy way would be to dump something on you. So it took quite a while. to get us something that I'm personally very happy with. Especially like the CT Numa, when you think about it, how machine dependent that is and how the language committee members managed to abstract it out so that's still useful but powerful. I hope at the end of the talk you agree with me. So tasking has been there for a longer time, but endorsement is quite low, which is a pity because it's a nice mechanism, but not many use it. So I want to kind of spend some time on it, on the basics. Threat cancellation and accelerator support I'll mention, but I'll do that briefly. Again, I refer to the tutorials for them. Threat cancellation idea is simple, but it's still powerful. It's like throwing an exception. A threat now can basically throw an error and others need to catch it. Same idea. But now you can do that at the OpenMP level. So you do that, it's kind of a little bit funny, you do that through a pragma, not a runtime function. But you can say, okay, there's something wrong and I wanna throw an error. And the others, depending on where they are in the execution, they either may catch it or may not catch it, as with an exception. Exactly the same idea, but now extended to OpenMP. And I still hope this is the first step into a more robust handling of failures. I'm not sure how much work is being done on that, but I think it is important to, at the application level, to be able to handle errors. So you do that by having cancellation points, and that's where you check whether the cancellation has been activated. Has been thrown, I should say. And depending on when that happens, you may or may not see the bad thing that happened. And there are defined cancellation points implied, and you can define your own. So the thread or threads that want to kind of throw that cancellation, they kind of funny, you know, you don't execute a pragma. They have this one, so the syntax is still, I'm not sure why it's not a runtime thing, but you would have if a less than zero, pragma OMP cancel. Kind of borderline elegant, but the other ones will have a certain point the cancellation, and you can have multiple constructs like the task group that I didn't mention yet for sections for So you say, I want to have a catch the cancellation point that may have been thrown in the section. Again, the specs will clarify that. Accelerator support, a world in itself, a big step forward. You all know this. This is the typical machine model. You got a host, and you got a bunch of accelerators and GPUs. The problem is, there are two problems with that. They have a probably they may have a different instruction set running, so that's what you need to handle. But certainly, the memory model is entirely different. So those are the big hurdles you need to take when you want to start supporting this. And currently, in 4.0, the model is you have multiple targets but all the same architecture. And you define through the pragmas what you want to offload to those devices. What I think is nice is it's embedded in your familiar OpenMP environment. So you don't have to do anything else than identify the target block of code that needs to be executed on the devices. So it's a more natural, less disruptive approach. So, extremely simple example, OMP target device number 2, this is what you want to do. This is what you want to execute. And just the compiler and runtime system will take care of it. Of course, the trick here is in the data handling, where you need to specify what goes in, what goes out, or the to from is it goes in and it goes out. But again, the moving of the data movement is handled by the runtime system. So you don't have any specific controls to do that. You specify that as a pragma level, and the runtime system will kick in. I know this is very short, very brief, but that's the basic idea. Again, details are for other tutorials. I want to spend more time on tasking, especially since I don't even understand exactly why, but endorsement is too low for what it is. And so what I'm going to do with this part of the talk is I want to build the fundamentals. And then I hope that you feel confident enough to open up the specs and look up the detail. Already been there for many years. I mean, it was introduced in 3.0. And before that, you really had to be either very naive or very brave, maybe both, to do things like divide and conquer, recursive algorithm, linked list. You could probably do all of it, but it requires a lot of ugly programming in OpenMP to do that. You would have to modify your sequential code. Not pretty at all. Initially, the functionality was extremely simple, and that's by design. The idea was, well, we're starting a whole new world of algorithms that people can parallelize. We're not exactly sure what else is needed beyond the basics, so we'll let users tell us what's needed, and that's happening now. That's being put into subsequent releases of the specs, and I'll touch a bit on that. So what is a task? It's simply anything that you want it to be a task. You use an OpenMP pragma to define a certain code block, and that's going to be the task. That's your responsibility. The assumption is that multiple tasks can execute in parallel without any sort of negative interference. And then the compiler and runtime system will take care of everything else. But that's a mixed blessing, because you don't know where things will run, for example. That's one of the things that's still struggling with, how much control do you want to give to the user where tasks are actually executed. But you give up all that kind of low-level control. But it works. So pragma OP task has some clauses on it. But it's overall quite simple. So here's my parallel region. And all I do here is, let's say I have that print statement, and this is how I make it a task. Now, as written, this will give you funny output because all the threads will execute all the tasks. And again, this is not very meaningful to do it this way, but that's how you define the task. All threads will start executing. So that brings the question, who does what? So if there's an explicit task, as I was showing with the pragma, when a thread encounters that, it will be generated, but, and here's the big catch, not necessarily executed. And that makes for some funny reading of your own source code, because you see the task. And unlike other OpenMP constructs, it's not necessarily executed. Now, you don't need that, anyway, but that does make for some funny reading of your source. Because execution of the task is totally handled by the runtime system, and the different strategies from different runtime systems. And what the runtime system will do, it will generate the tasks and then assign them to whoever wants to execute them, which depends on, for example, the thread's availability. So either the task is executed immediately or it could be done later. Outside, almost outside of your control. Now, let's even have the freedom to suspend the task region and switch task. That's called the task scheduling. That's in the interest of performance. You think, oh, there's something else I want to do? Then go ahead. Now, this is, I wouldn't say tricky, but it's not straightforward either. If you really want to challenge yourself, you can nest tasks. So it works, And for some algorithms, that's a natural thing to do, but I would stick with the one level first, and then see if you can refine. So when is a task executed? And it happens at the end of that block, when, but not necessarily when it's generated. Again, this is the big thing with tasks. You can force execution through the task synchronization constructs, and there are implied moments in time where the tasks are being executed. You know they'll be executed, but if you don't want that, you can enforce execution. And you do that with the task wait. So at the task wait point in your code, all pending tasks, all child tasks, direct child tasks will be executed. If you have a deeper structure, you need a task group to do that. That was added later. Initially, this was the behavior and that was it. Some people said, no, that's not enough. I need more control. And that's why you have the task group, where you group tasks, and then you know everything underneath is going to be executed. A very common way people implement tasking is the following. There's one thread that will generate the tasks, and it will submit that into a queuing system. And then, one by one, these tasks are generated, and as they become available, other threads will start executing. Until this one is finished, then it may join in the computation. So how do you achieve that? That's going to show a little funny syntax that I'll show you. That's the model. Typically, one thread will generate the tasks, only generate, and others are picking up work. And I know, usually by this time, you lost about 110% of the audience. So it's time for an example. And a really simple one. I think actually that's one of the reasons why people run away from tasking, because the examples shown are fairly horrendous if you haven't gone through the basics. So I'm only going to show you a very simple example, and I'll do that very slowly. So hopefully by that you have a better feel for the concept, and then you can go back into the specs and look at, you know, more real world. So here's the assignment or the task. I just couldn't resist it. You get asked to write a parallel program that either prints a race car or a car race and maximize the parallelism. That's the assignment. How would you do that? Here's my sequential version, written in a little bit of a clunky way. A preprint essay. And I promise you no questions to the audience. Well, I think everybody here will get this one right, because it will print, you can compile it, and it will print a race car, of course. But I don't have parallelism. This is a sequential version. Now, this would be the wrong solution. I have a parallel region, and anybody there to guess what this will print, but it will definitely not print what I intended to print, because all threads execute all code in the parallel region. So you get an arbitrary mix of these three, but in a specific order. One thread will have to do first A, then race car, so you get A race car, car race, for example. You get the order. But it comes out very funny, and I ran it a couple of times, and indeed you get fairly broken English out of your program. And theoretically, you can even see more combinations, but I didn't really see them, probably because of the buffering of the IO. But I hope you get it. This is wrong. Now I could cheat. I'll only have one do it. That was a homework assignment. You wouldn't pass. So now I get what I want, but again, there's no parallelism. again, very obvious. Now let's use that tasking mechanism to get to our goal. And here comes, in a way it's kind of funny, although in a nerdy way it's funny. Pragma OMP parallel, and this is why I showed you the single just before, there is a single here. That doesn't make any sense. Think about it. They all go parallel, only one. So what was done was this mechanism was abused to implement the task. I'm quite sure there were many good reasons for it, but the scary thing is when you've seen it often enough, you don't notice it anymore. But what happens here is, okay, there's a bunch of threads. They start executing the parallel region. Only one will do the single region. That was the definition of single region. So one will do that. The other one will wait in the barrier here because there's no work for them. So that one thread will print A, and then it will generate two tasks. And notice the word generate. They're not necessarily executed yet. That's why I try to stress that a bit. You don't know when this will be executed other than in a specific tasking point. And that happens to be the barrier, one of them. So what will happen, one thread will print this one. The runtime system will have a queue with two tasks on it. And those will be executed by whatever threads here. I hope that's clear. This is kind of at the heart of the tasking model. So you get your parallel. It works. Not often enough, you'll see that car race or race car, and it works. But we're not done yet. So I want you to add, the end is fun to watch. And I've had enough university classes to, like most professors, add a useless end, use a print statement. Of course you need to use a print statement. They give me a hint and I have no idea until it's too late what the hint was about. So that's what this means. Okay. So we'll use a print statement. Okay, so I got this, and I want to have the print statement only once, so it should be in that single. So I have here, a race car is fun to watch. This is wrong. This won't do what you think it does, because remember, this is not a task. So the task will be executed here, or some other later point. That's the whole magic of the task. So what you'll see is A is fun to watch, and then car race or race car. That's exactly what you see. Again, fairly broken English, not what we want. So the solution is, the solution is to have the task wait. That forces these tasks to be completed first before I print. So that's why you need things like task wait to say, wait a minute, we're all gotta be complete. So that works, that achieved the goal. Okay. Now I grossly skipped many things. One of them I didn't even want to go into is the data model. By default, the data is first private for tasks. You really have to, as with all these data scoping things, you really have to think about who's using my data in what way. Should it be shared? You have the same mechanisms, the private and shared, the first private. And tasking is nothing more that adds to it, but you just have to think about a task. Should that be shared? And what if a task modifies some shared variable, you have to embed it in a critical region or an atomic update or something like that. Now, nothing has changed. There are default rules, and one of them is data is first private by default. So it can make things a little easier, but it's still the same recommendation. Think about how you're using it. And again, that's that's one of those things that will be covered in those supercomputing tutorials much more. Okay. I want to finish this overview by thread affinity. Because thread affinity is affecting all of you. And that's why I think it's worth covering. So why worry? It used to be that what I'm talking about next was only for the ones that had access to a monstrously big shared memory machine, where the memory was all scheduled. Now, even a two-socket system, it doesn't matter who you buy it from, unless it was manufactured 40 years ago, has a CC NUMA architecture. So that's what we're going to talk about. And in the performance part, I'll show you how these things can kind of hurt you and how you can possibly fix it. So here's a generic system architecture. I have a processor. The processor could have multiple cores and multiple threads. What's important is that all modern designs with scalability have put the memory controller onto the chip. So the processor has direct access to a chunk of memory, and they all have. So if you wouldn't do anything special, if this was a regular interconnect like InfiniBand or whatever, you would have an MPI cluster. Now, on a shared memory system, there is an interconnect, but it has support for what's called cache coherence. And what that essentially means is that every thread knows what's going on in the entire memory system at the same time. So you have visibility of the whole address range, all of the memory. This processor can easily transparently access this memory over that interconnect. So it gives very great ease of use. You'll have a big shared memory system. That's how it shows to you. When you run like top, it will tell you, you've got so many gigabytes or terabytes of memory. The fact it's physically distributed, you don't see it at that level. But for performance, you have to take that into account. And that's a long, been there for quite a while, that problem, but it was reserved for those big shared memory systems. Now, you buy a two-socket system, this is your architecture. The reason, the good technology reason why it was done is where you add processors, you add bandwidth. Instead of having the old style shared bus where you would saturate the bus as you added processors. So now you have a more scalable bandwidth. The price to pay is the notion of data locality. So the question is, where does your data go? And it could be here. That's fine. That's fine if I'm running here. I have the fastest data access. It's not so fine when my thread is running on the other processor. I not only pay a performance penalty to get to that data, if many threads all get to that data, you saturate that memory controller. So you have a hotspot there, and everybody else is doing that at the memory level. So the two reasons. The remote access time is one of them, the biggest one, but also the saturation of the memory controller. So this is bad. And as a long-standing issue, known, and OpenMP didn't handle it well until today. It all goes back to the operating system. The OS ultimately is in charge of where your data goes, but you can tweak. So what OS does, and as far as I know, every OS out there uses this policy. It's called first touch, and it is exactly what the name suggests. The one who touches the data first will own it. And that makes perfect sense, because when you talk about a sequential program, there's only one owner, and you want to have all that data local to your memory, not far away. So this choice makes perfect sense for sequential programs. It doesn't always make sense for a parallel program. So here's my same imaginary system, and here's a loop with 10,000 iterations, and I'm initializing a vector to zero. If I wouldn't do anything special, one thread would execute that loop and therefore own all the data. And again, if somebody else needs the data, I could be in trouble because they have to travel all the internet and all the bad things happen. The solution is very easy, I can actually use first touch to my advantage. And in this imaginary case, for demonstration purposes, I use the num threads clause on the parallel region to only get two threads. That's not how you would do it in real life, but I use two threads here. What will happen, these 10,000 iterations will be chopped in 2 × 5,000, and each thread will initialize a portion of that vector. So they'll run in parallel, and they'll each get half of that vector, and I hopefully have achieved my goal. Now there's something I need to point out here. Allocation in memory is done at the page level. So that is, think about 4 kilobyte, 8 kilobyte by default. So you talk about a fairly, relatively large chunk of data. The OS only knows about pages. It doesn't know about cache lines and all that stuff. So when it allocates, but in this way, I can exploit the first touch to my advantage. It does create some funny coding sometimes, because it's sometimes beneficial to pre-initialize some data, although you don't have to pre-initialize it. Especially, let's say you do I/O. You read from a file. That's typically done by one thread. If you wouldn't do anything, that one thread would own all the data, and you have exactly this problem. So what you can do, which is somewhat of a hack, is pre-initialize all these data structures in parallel. And then the placement has been decided. And when it comes to reading, they all go their own way in the system. And it does help. I'll show you in the performance part, I'll show you. It does help. It's not kid stuff. It does work. Okay. So for the thread affinity model in OpenMP, here's the machine model to keep in mind. In that model, what you have is a bunch of sockets. The sockets have one or multiple cores, and each core has one or multiple hardware threads. And an example is the Intel processor. We have a bunch of cores, and each core has two threads. As I'll briefly touch upon this afternoon, we have 8 threads per core. So there's a difference, you know, for whatever hardware you use, but it's a pretty generic machine model, because that's what the industry is doing today. These cores have access to caches and memory. I stripped out the caches here because they're not part of the OpenMP affinity support, luckily. There's just memory. And that memory is local to those cores. And you have multiple memories, and they're glued together through a cache coherent interconnect. So any hardware thread can access any memory location throughout the system. It behaves like one big shared memory system. Exactly that OpenMP chart with all these bubbles that I was showing many, many slides ago. That's the model. This is how the hardware works. So it's absolutely key that threads are close to the data they need most often. The need most often is important because it's virtually impossible to get the optimal placement all the time. You got to make trade-offs. Well, you need the data 80% of the time. Too bad with those 20%. You're very lucky if you don't have that. That's nice, but you can't count on that. So you make the trade-off. Okay, that's what I'm going to optimize. The benefits are, again, you no longer have as many remote memory references. You maximize the bandwidth because you're all accessing your memory at the same time instead of one thread going through one memory controller. You get reduced latency because your data is closer by. The philosophy in OpenMP is data is wherever it may be. You're not going to move the data. You're going to move the thread. And the reason is that that's much cheaper. It's much cheaper to pack up a thread and move it to the data than package up all the data and move it to the thread. So it's a very, very simple choice in a way. But it does tie in, and that's why I mentioned it, the first touch. The first touch lets you control where the data is, more or less. And then you want to make sure that the threads are, that are needed are close to it with the affinity control. So you get two pieces in this puzzle to play with. The first one is called the playlist, the place list. Okay. Freudian sip. That defines, the place list defines where things can run. And that's totally under your control. It's up to you how much of the system you want to use. Then you specify the affinity policy of all those resources that you specified, where threads should go, where you allow them to go. So there's two design choices you need to make, and of course I'll go into all the detail on that. The place list. At the end of the day, the place is a bunch of numbers. Those are the raw, not even hardware numbers, those are the numbers the OS assigns to those hardware threads. The assignment of numbers is OS specific, but at the end of the day, that's what is being used. Now, disclaimer, you don't have to work with this, I'll show you, but this is eventually what will happen deep inside set of numbers. And I introduced a little bit of my own wording because I'm not even sure what the specs say about this. I call these numbers a scheduling unit. It's something that can execute instructions, like a hardware chip. That's what it is. It's something that the OS knows about and can assign a thread to, because that's what ultimately needs to happen. What I just said, thread can run on that, and it could be a hardware. Now, there are different approaches. You can have a single element place all by itself. That's usually not a good idea because you need to give the OS the freedom to schedule things if you can. And often you can, actually. I'll show you that. So that's why I have a happy face and an unhappy face. I'd like to go for the multi-element. So here's an imaginary system that I'll be using throughout the rest of this part of the talk. I assume I have a simple two-socket system, as I was showing. I assume each socket, that is for layout purposes, so it fits on the slide, there's only two cores, and there are four threads per core. So in total, across the whole system, they'll give me 16 threads to play with. And here's a drawing of that imaginary system, now without the dots. So two sockets, socket 0, socket 1, core 0, core 1, core 0, core 1 in each, and then the four hardware threads per core. That's how my hardware is built and connected to some interconnect. So although that's not necessarily the way the OS numbers these things, I know for sure Linux doesn't do that, but this is my imaginary numbering, so 0, 1, 2, 15. And as an example, if my list with numbers consists of the set, if the place list is a set, the places are sets 0, 1, 2, 3, I tell the system, I only want you to use this core, because that's these 400. I hope that's clear. So 0, 1, 2, 3 is my way to identify socket 0, core 0. Now, don't worry, there's other ways to specify this. But again, this is what happens deep inside the system, ultimately. Now, luckily, the people who designed this, and I think they did a really good job, they give us a very convenient interval notation. There's one thing that took me a little bit by surprise. 0 is the starting number, but 4 is the count, not the last one. And this is the stride. Yeah, it took me by surprise. So It's just a choice, you just have to know about it. So what this says, you start counting by zero, I want to have four elements and the increment is one. So zero, one, two, three. It's the same, but a much more compact notation and less error prone, because with these large systems, these lists can get really long. So you really don't want to use it. You really want to stick with this kind of notation. The order of these numbers doesn't matter within that set, within a place. So this set is exactly the same as if I would reverse the number. Doesn't matter. And what you want to do there, the reason is that you want to reflect to the OS, it doesn't matter where you run. Because these are at the memory hierarchy level, they all see the same hierarchy. So it doesn't matter whether you pick 3 or 0 or 1. And you give the OS some freedom to pick one that may be not in use. So when you go to it, the lower you go, the more you restrict the choice, the harder you make it for the OS to do a good job. So that's some sort of balancing act that you want to do. In any case, it's all the same, doesn't matter. And again, the idea behind it makes total perfect sense is the assumption is there's no difference regarding the memory hierarchy. And the case in point is these are the hardware threads within one core. At a core level, you see the same level one caches, the same level two, and whatever. So your memory system is exactly the same. So why would you prefer one over the other? There's no need to control the affinity at such a low level. Now to not hopefully add to the confusion, but you can start combining these places into a list. Because I usually don't have one place, I have multiple places, like this. So here I have two places with these numbers, whatever they represent in the architecture. And here, the order does matter. And that actually makes sense as well, because when you start specifying affinity, it ties into the order in which you specify things. So here, the order does matter. Not a big deal, but something you need to know. So insulting on your intelligence, that's what this shows. Okay. So how do you define the place list? There's that environment variable OMP places. And I'll just show you some examples. As I was just showing, this gives me two places. This is one, and this is another. But luckily, there's the interval notation. So this is how I write it. And I strongly suggest that you do that too, because again, it's so easy to make a mistake and these lists get very long. So again, one more time, this starts at hardware thread 8. There are 4 of them with an increment of 1. So there's 8, 9, 10, and 11.
There's a question about
OMP
places. Yeah. How do you use this with multiple entry and rank from those?
I'm afraid I don't know. I'm afraid I can't tell. I do know the combination of MPI and OpenMP has been given thought, but we would have to check. Sorry.
Depends on how the compiler knows about MPI.
Right.
I know some compilers are aware of. Okay. Here you have two places. Does that mean you have 8 threads or two threads?
I didn't say anything about threads yet.
Yeah, okay.
These are, it's good that you bring it up. These are the candidate targets where I want to run some. And the next step is you choose how many threads you want, and then you decide how you want to map them onto those places. So that's your second choice to make.
The first bracket, 0, 1, 2, 3, means if I have a thread trying to find onto this place, I can migrate freely.
Yes, right,
before.
Right. So to help us out, the people who designed this give us abstract names, and they're very obvious. Sockets, cores, or threads, so you don't have to bother with these low-level numbers. You just say, give me all the sockets in your system, whatever they are, or cores or threads. Now, the funny thing is, in the specs, say, this is not defined, this is implementation dependent. So you hope and of course can expect that the implementer actually uses the software. It would be rather bizarre not to do that. So, so assuming they do the right thing, which I think we can safely assume, you could say, my places consist of all the cores in the system. So that's a much nicer way of, instead of using those low-level numbers. You still, once in a while, actually, you need those low-level numbers, but in most cases, this gets you going. Now, you can even say, I only want to use four cores, so you give a number. That's where things get tricky for me, because I don't know which cores qualify. That's when I go to my numbering system. Unless you don't care. But think about a large machine with, you know, cores everywhere. What do you really mean when you say four cores? It's convenient, but you really have to think about it and whether that's acceptable. But it's supported, and the implementation is free to add additional names. These are always available, but if somebody has some architecture where they feel like they need more, they can add that to it. But of course, you lose portability in your script and in your code, but that's fine. So very simple example, on my imaginary system, if I say OpenMP places equals cores, this is the low-level list that's being generated for those four cores I had in my hardware, or more compact using the interval notation, you can do this. And then I couldn't resist, I got carried away a little bit. You can nest the interval notation. So this whole thing can be reduced to this one, because this means this one is repeated four times with an increment of four. Again, it takes maybe a little while to get used to, but once you start to get this, you appreciate the robustness of it. But all three are fine. So this defines where threads are allowed to run. Now we want to define how to schedule them. And that's controlled through the affinity policy. That defines which places they're being used. And you do that in a symbolic way, master, close, or spread. And so far, I assumed that environment variable level, the places are defined at the environment level, environment variable level. This one you can do on the parallel region as well. You can either say I define it uniform across my application, or each parallel region has its own kind of affinity policy. Now, I can imagine you don't want to do that on 1,000 different parallel regions, but the possibility is there. And if you don't say anything, the environment variable will be the default. Now, the binding, as Helen said, the binding is at the place level. So again, more choice in within a place gives you more freedom. So there are three policies. There's the master policy, where everybody really likes to be close to the master. There's the close policy, where we all like to be cozy and to each other. Or the spread policy, where you want to spread out. Looks very impressive, my friend. So. And again, you set that through proc bind, OMP proc bind. And it's as simple as saying spread, or if you have nested regions, you do spread and then close. So in that way, you for example, this is what you want to do here is you want to first spread the threads, and additional threads on there should be closed because you want to keep them in the same box. So you can mix and match anything you like. I think in practice you'll mostly use spread and close. Master is for more special cases. And as I said, this is at the environment variable level. This is used for every parallel region. you can always make the exception by using the proc bind clause on the specific LL region for the special case or whatever. Okay. So the place list defines what's available. That's fixed. That's going to be it. The dynamic part is the binding, where you define the placement, and that can and probably will change from parallel region to parallel region. That's really up to you. So how you want to. So going back to my simple example, I would say OMP places equals cores. That means in my system I have four places. And when you look in the specs, it's defined as an algorithm what that means in terms of your policy. So if I use the spread, what I really want to express here, I got four cores, and let's say I got four threads for demonstration purposes. I want each core to run one thread. That's what I want to do. If you would say eight, it starts wrapping around. That way, and that's actually how I use it most of the time. This gets you there. Like I said, the one thing I feel a little bit awkward about is if you restrict the number of cores, you don't know who's being selected. But the OMP display end will tell you, because that will show you the place. Okay, so in that simple example, I got my imaginary architecture. So what will happen is I got. And since I said spread, they will run on different places, and on purpose I show different hardware threads being used, because you can't make that assumption. So it's as easy as that. And to summarize, and then 5 minutes. I've said this so many times, but it's really, like I said, the nice thing I like about it, when I get an idea, and affinity is a good example, changing from spreading the threads to keeping them close is setting an environment variable. You can see what happens to the performance of your application. And that's what I like. Now with all the modern controls being put in, you can have the old style regular parallelism that has been there for a long time, but you can also do the more unstructured parallelism, the more dynamic parallelism. And you can master your CCMU architecture, and if you connect it with accelerators, you can control all of that. And pick your compiler, and pretty much guarantee it'll support OpenMP. And if not, complain to them, then they'll have it next year for you. Okay, so that was it. As a little teaser into the next presentation after lunch. You may have wondered why I was showing that, Paul. Well, that was the missing part in the OpenMP thing. Not that OpenMP doesn't scale, bad OpenMP does not scale. But we'll talk about that after the lunch break. I think that's 1:30, isn't it?
We'll meet again. Back at 1:30. So now it ends the morning session. I promise you, the afternoon session will be even more fun, dynamic and engaged. So I understand it's late for the East Coast people, but we encourage you to come back. I hope you
ask some
questions. I go through all the questions we have in the chat room. Yeah, I'll answer privately.
Okay.
So if you do have more questions, type in the chat window, please. And so I hope you have already learned a lot of tricks and tips from Ruud this morning. And he's indeed a very good speaker. So I invited him to the HPCF, which is High Performance Computing and Simulation Conference this summer in Amsterdam, where Ruud is based, and for an OpenMP tutorial. It was an all day. Ruud has mentioned, he's also giving lots of other tutorials at supercomputing and other conferences. But I understand it's not easy for our users to go to all these big conferences and even to pay for like one day tutorial, things like that. Oracle headquarters in the Bay Area. He comes here often. That's why I invited him to come here for NERSC users. It's a great tutorial. And we also broadcast to other DOE labs, so there are other I use some of those labs as well, and we are kind of full, a big attendance today. So thank you.
You're welcome, and I hope to see you back after lunch. I promise you'll try not to put you to sleep.
After lunch, I'll take a lot of questions.